Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum. Terima kasih Dr. Zamzira. Actually, Dr. Zamzira is a gynecologist from UPU for introduction. Yang dihormati Dr. Lewis Handen, Nyalas Kuinji Masa Amishel, Dato' Dr. Lazal Ismail, Pengurusi Dr. Kosa Gynecology DFTPOG, Prof. Sharifah Ma'ma, yang juga guru saya dulu tahun 90-an, very dedicated lecturer and privilege, dan tuan-tuan dan perempuan yang mati sekalian, thank you very much for coming to attend this symposium. So actually the burden of cervical cancer is a very important topic, and that's, this is the main reason why we are organizing this session, this event, this 4 days. Three symposium yesterday attended by more than 100 over paramedics and pathologists, and today and tomorrow we have a variety of personnel from various category, doctors, pharmacists, oncologists and so on. So I hope that this lecture will give some insight on the burden of cervical cancer in Malaysia as well as global. I would like to welcome Datuk Dr. Azmi Syafiee, Pengarah Penolongan Perubatan, dan Datuk Dr. Marzuki Mahisa, Pengarah Kesihatan Negeri Kedah. Thank you for coming. Thank you very much. So, burden of cervical cancer globally and locally. And if you look at the world cancer statistic as a whole, cancer kills more people than AIDS, TB, and malaria combined, and will soon become the world's single leading cause of death. And if you look at the 2008 statistic, 12.7 million new cancer cases reported, and 7.6 million women died of cancer. And the National Agency of Research on Cancer predicted 27 million new cancer cases and 17 million cancer deaths in 2030, with a growth rate of 1% annually. And you look at global current 2008, lung cancer is still the number one, followed by breast and then colorectal cancer. Three most important factors contributed to increase in world cancer incidence are growth and increase in life expectancy, cigarette smoking, and also factors related to food and physical inactivity. Okay, this table shows world and most common cancer in women based on Global Can 2008. Breast cancer is the most common cancer worldwide, followed by colorectal and cervical cancer, actually number three. There is some mistake actually posted in Global Can website. They put cervical cancer number two, but actually look at the number, cervical cancer is number three most common cancer, woman cancer in the world in 2008. Despite of being a number three most common cancer in the world, cervical cancer actually more fatal, more deadly as compared to breast cancer. This can be measured by what we call the mortality incidence ratio of breast cancer, which is 33% as compared to cervical cancer, which is much higher, 52%. And according to a Global Can 2008, 529,000 new cases of cervical cancer was reported in 2008. Cervical cancer was responsible in total of 275,000 deaths, and 88% of deaths occurred in less developed nations, including Asia. And regions with highest risk are Africa, South Central Asia, especially in India, and South America, while the region with lowest risk are Western Asia, North America, Australia, and New Zealand. And look at the back here, Asia contributed almost 60% of the number of total number of cervical cancer worldwide, mainly because of the high population and high incidence rate, especially from South Central Asia countries, mainly India. And again, for the same reason, 58% of cervical cancer death was reported from Asia. Mortality rate is highest in less developed countries such as Africa, South Central Asia, and Latin America. And mortality rate is lowest in developed countries such as Australia, New Zealand, North America, Europe, and some of the Western Asia countries due to early detection, probably, and also early facilities for treatment.
In Malaysia, cervical cancer is the third most common human cancer based on the NCI 2006, and overall, cervical cancer is the fourth most common cancer both in men and women. And this constituted 9.2% of total female cancer with age standardized scale of 12.2 per 100,000 population. If you look at here, cervical cancer is number 3 major female cancer in Peninsular Malaysia, not include the Sabah and Sarawak. And overall, in Peninsular Malaysia, men and women, cervical cancer is fourth most common cancer. And among the ethnic group in Malaysia, Chinese has the highest risk of cervical cancer. The total number of cervical cancer reported in Chinese was higher than Malay, despite of being constituting the 35% population as compared to 54.3% Malay. And the incidence rates of cervical cancer in Malay is lowest, which is 7.3 per 100,000 population. Okay, the next slide, I think, will focus and to the actual burden of the cervical cancer to everyone. I divided the burdens of cervical cancer into two main categories, which is disease-related and treatment-related burden, and both has a significant impact on the physical, psychological, social, sexual, and financial aspect. We know that cervical cancer is a disease with a very well-defined invasive state, and high radiation has a very close relation to invasive disease. And therefore, when we are talking about invasive cervical cancer, we can actually put aside the importance of addressing the burden of disease related to detection and treatment of the pre-invasive state. And looking into the wider perspective on impact, cervical cancer is only small at the tip of iceberg or at the tip of the pyramid. And we can see the huge burden of cervical cancer is actually also imposed by the problem related to other conditions caused by human papillomavirus infection. Study on the quality of life has shown that women with cervical cancer have significantly lower quality of life score compared to women with breast and ovarian cancer. Cervical cancer significantly diminishes the quality of life due to severe emotional distress, anxiety, physical and psychosexual impairment. And the psychosexual and social burden imposed by cervical cancer is very significant. Patients with cervical cancer have been reported to have various psychological and sexual symptoms, such as changes in body image, loss of interest in sexual activity, reduced self-esteem, lack of confidence, dysthymia, apareunia, failure to achieve orgasm and depression. And many of them were actually facing marital disharmony, mainly related to psychosexual difficulties and some to financial and other problems. And the prevalence of significant sexual dysfunction was approximately 20-30%, and some studies showed much higher prevalence, with average of about quarters of cases. This our local study, who actually did, one of the master students, a psychiatric master student from UKM, conducted the study in our unit in HSD. She did the cross-sectional descriptive study of 120 patients in our units, looking at the prevalence of major depressive disorder, quality of life, and sexual dysfunction. You can see the study has shown that the prevalence of major depressive disorder was 18%, and 65% of patients suffer the sexual dysfunction. Interestingly, you look at the prevalence of sexual dysfunction according to the type of cancer. Cervical cancer patient has a much highest prevalence of sexual dysfunction, 71%, as compared to the endometrial and ovarian cancer. In many studies, patients with cervical cancer experiencing more anxiety, dysphoria, anger, and confusion as compared to other gynecological cancer patients. And all the burden that I have been highlighted actually quite easy to understand, to explain. We know that this condition, the cancer, is targeting the organ that located at the center of the pelvis, which is surrounded by a very important structures involved in the urination, involved in the defecation, involved in the sexual function, and involved in the renal function, as well as involved in the reproductive functions. Urinary obstruction is one of the most important complications of cervical cancer. The ureter is only about 1 to 2 cm lateral of the cervix, and obstructive nephropathy is one of the most common causes of morbidity and mortality in cervical cancer. And treatment for urinary obstruction is very troublesome, and patients may need to use the nephrostomy tube for life. Disease and treatment can both lead to fistula formation, rectovaginal fistula, vesicovaginal fistula, and in some cases both vesicovaginal and rectovaginal fistula, causing total loss in sexual function, defecation, and urination. In patients with stage 4 disease, the cancer can spread to lung, brain, liver, and other sort of organs. This can be fatal and in some cases cause slow and painful death. Cervical cancer can also be disabling and painful if it spread to joint and bone, and in this case, it spread to knee joint and spine and also to the pelvic bone. This is very pelvic bones, and this is very, very painful. In the operable disease, patient has to undergo radical hysterectomy and pelvic lymphadenectomy. The surgery is complex and of course carries a significant morbidity. And one of the most common long-term complications of radical hysterectomy is chronic bladder dysfunction. Even after complete treatment, 20 to 30% of patients with operable disease develop recurrence of cancer. In local recurrence, at least, upper vaginectomy and possibly post-operative radiotherapy will further worsening the vaginal function and other complications of surgery and radiotherapy. And this is specimen taken from both posterior examination. We have to remove the rectum and also the upper part of the vagina in patient who has a recurrence of the cervical cancer. In worst scenario, you can see we have to remove almost all the pelvic organs in total pelvic examination, where we have to remove the bladder, the vagina, the rectum, all together in block, and can see empty pelvis, and then patient has to use the permanent colostomy and the leukonduit for life. And this is a super ultra radical surgery where we have to remove everything, rectum, all the reproductive organs, including the vulva as well. And many of the cervical cancer patients were diagnosed during pregnancy with a prevalence of 1 in 60,000 delivery. And the management of this disease in pregnancy is very complicated. In majority of cases, patient has to sacrifice their future reproductive function. Overall, as high as 60% of patients with cervical cancer require radiotherapy, either as an adjuvant treatment or as a primary therapy. Radiotherapy can cause skin irritation, lymphedema, radiation infarctus, and also a premature ovarian failure. Brachytherapy can lead to a vaginal stenosis, radiation cystitis, and radiation proctitis. Some percentage of patients with cervical cancer also require a chemotherapy, either in the chemoradiation regimes, in new adjuvant setting, or as the primary treatment for metastatic and recurrence disease. There are a long list of chemotherapy-induced toxicity, and some are shown in this slide. According to the NCR 2006, malignant neoplasm is the third most common cause of death in Asia after septicemia and heart disease, and soon will become the number one cause of death in Asia. And thousands of young women in their reproductive age group fail their battle and lost their life to cervical cancer every year. Mortality rate of cervical cancer in underdeveloped and developing countries are higher due to lack in the facility for prevention and treatment of this cancer. And the number of deaths in less developed countries is actually constituted more than 80% of total death due to same reasons, because and also late presentation. Last but not least,
very important. The financial burden imposed this disease and this bladder cancer, which is very tremendous. This is a figure from American Cancer Society, and as they have a very good data collection, I think this data is more reliable. And you can see that the total health cost of screening and treatment of bladder cancer is $4 to $6 billion a year. And as far as Indonesia is concerned, we have the data in 2003, which was evaluated by Prof. Sheikh Juni in 2003, which is 8 years ago. He evaluated the economic burden of cervical cancer in Indonesia, and he estimated that the average annual health cost of treatment and of pre-invasive and invasive cervical cancer was almost 215 million ringgit. And it could be as high as 421 million ringgit. And in summary, more than 58% of newly diagnosed cervical cancer was reported from Asia, mainly from South Central Asia, India, with high population and high incidence rate of cervical cancer. 88% of cervical cancer death was from less developed countries. Cervical cancer is the third most common human cancer in Asia, based on NCR 2006. Cervical cancer is the fourth most common cancer in Malaysia, in terms of Malaysia, both in men and women. Cervical cancer is associated with significant physical, social, psychological, sexual and financial burden. Patients with cervical cancer has lower quality of life as compared to breast and ovarian cancer. Radiation of cervical cancer can potentially save an average of 250 million ringgit annually for Malaysia. With that, thank you very much for your attention.